And I was excited to see the two papers that we have this afternoon. One thing I always say in my work is that while black art is highly pleasurable, it's certainly exciting, definitely demonstrates black excellence. But it's also been the site, I think, of important social activism. There's something about black music, black voices, poetry, and bodies that can make visible, right, what is it rendered invisible by racism and oppression. We have two papers this afternoon, followed by a discussion by our very own Riche Richardson here at Africana. The first paper will be given by Michelle Scott. She is an associate professor in the history department at the University of Maryland, Baltimore College. She's a faculty member in Africana Studies, Gender and Women's Studies, and also does work on language, literacy, and culture. Her book, Black Empress and Black Chattanooga, Betsy Smith and Emerging Urban South, was published by the University of Illinois Press. The second paper will be by Scot Brown. He's actually one of Professor Harris's former doctoral students here at Cornell. We are representing. All right, we are representing here. Scot Brown is currently a professor of history at the University of California, Los Angeles. He's the author of the pioneering book, Fighting for Us, a study of cultural nationalism and the Black Power Movement during the 1960s and 1970s. They also just learned that he's working on an edited volume looking at the work of Professor Turner. All right. And so we'll begin with Professor Scott's paper, A Disgraceful Affair. Thank you very much.
To celebrate the retirement of Professor Robert Harris. Professor Harris met me when I was 19 years old, and I was a summer research exchange participant from Stanford for that summer. To just date myself, it was 1994. And in that summer, he sent me off to, of all places, the law school library to study the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And I was coming from the King Papers Project, so I thought I knew everything about civil rights, and I was reading the speeches and sermons of Martin Luther King, and I got to the law school library and realized I didn't understand anything that I was reading. But what that quest did set me on was the quest, professional quest, to study African-American history, civil rights, and social justice in all of its forms. And Professor Harris continues to be a very important part of my life, both personally and professionally. About a half an hour away from where I live, so I expect to see him at my second office, which is Panera, where I do all my research and grading. And this paper is actually the answer to that ever-asked question that he asks me every time he sees me, usually twice a year. How's your research? When's that second book coming out? So this is the answer to that question. This is the project that's the beginning of my second book. A Disgraceful Affair, Racial Violence and Civil Rights in Black Vaudeville Theater in the Nadir. The dead body of Lewis F. Wright of Ottawa, Kansas, was found hanging to a tree this morning. He had been lynched during the night as a result of one of the most exciting incidents that ever disturbed this city. This exciting incident, as it was labeled in the mainstream New York Sun, occurred February 15, 1902. It was described a bit differently in the African-American Wichita Searchlight. Quote, the lynching of Lewis Wright, a member of Richard and Pringle's minstrels, in a small Missouri town last week, was a disgraceful affair. How long, O Lord? How long? In the past two decades, there have been several texts that analyze the spectacle of Southern lynching, examine the gender motivations of the crime, illuminate the legal implications of lynch law, and investigate the oral testimonies of racial violence in Black communities in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. There's a definitely rich and growing historiography of the horrors of racial violence in the midst of the Nadir, or the lowest point in race relations between 1877 and the early 1900s. Yet the Lewis Wright lynching, while part of the atrocities of the age, spoke to me for a completely different reason. Wright was a 22-year-old African-American trumpet player, lynched in connection with his job as a minstrel, a traveling Black theater performer. He was captured and arrested along with his whole troupe as they left the stage door and targeted for supposed acts of impudence towards white townsmen prior to the show. What physical horrors were involved in performing on the minstrel and vaudeville stages of the early 20th century? What were the civil rights transgressions linked to perfecting your musical, acting, or dancing craft as an African-American performer in the early United States? This question of racial violence and its link to Black variety or vaudeville theater is the focus of my talk this afternoon, which is very much still a work in progress, at least this part of my second work. By vaudeville, I specifically mean the variety theater performances that reached popularity in the United States from the 1890s to the 1930s. A typical vaudeville show offered an audience a little bit of everything in about 10 to 15 turns or different acts or scenes. It could consist of dance numbers, musical numbers, comic sketches, acrobatics, juggling, political speeches, anything and everything could be included in a vaudeville performance. And this research that I'm talking about today is part of my larger project on the origins and social functions of the TOBA, or the Theater Owners Booking Association, a variety theater circuit catering to Black working class audiences between 1920 to 1931. With its organizational roots stretching back to 1909 and a regional circuit in Memphis, the 1920s TOBA consisted of both Black and white managed theaters that contracted various Black entertainers into a systematic group of performances across the East, Midwest, and South. There are legends about performing on Toby Time, but the acronym is also known as Tough on Black Actors or Tough on Black Assets. And the complexities of performing in Toby Time are bound on the biographical sketches of performers like Ethel Waters or Sweet Mama Stringbean, as you see here in her early career, the Whitman sisters, Alberta Hunter, blues singer Ma Rainey, comic comedian Pygmy Markham, all these people you will later see on Apollo stages and hearing recordings of in the late 40s and 50s. Butterbeans and Susie, a comedy sketch scene, team with very risque comedy that I have a clip of that I might get to when I run out of time. And where I started everything with my first research, Bessie Smith. The legendary Bessie Smith started her career on the total stage. So how does this opening scene that I mentioned of racial violence arguably provide a facet of the origins of a Black theater circuit? Well, for that, let me weave the disgraceful story of Lewis Wright's death with the music and nuances of life of a traveling Black performer in the early 20th century. So let's talk a little bit about the musical foundations of vaudeville to set the stage for Wright. Between 1890 and 1910, popular Black music of the age consisted of minstrelsy, vaudeville, band music, particularly brass band music, and early blues. Black traveling shows could be in the form of a medicine show where you're actually performing to hawk snake oil or whatever variety of medicines that come to mind at the time, or lack thereof in terms of the actual medicinal quality. Circuses, tent shows, carnivals, and minstrel parades, all of which I started to study in the foundation of looking at blues performers like Bessie Smith and later in my work on Alberta Hunter. Now, as the 19th century came to a close, the most popular form or most popular avenues for African-American professionalized music and traveling entertainment was in the form of minstrelsy. And there are two different forms of minstrelsy. The general American genre in the country starts approximately between 1815 and 1820 in the northeastern United States. And initially, traditional American minstrels were troops of white males who performed in blackface makeup for an audience of predominantly working class white males. Historians and cultural theorists have argued about the functions of the early minstrel genre, and these discussions include minstrelsy being sheer entertainment, to a method for white entertainers to covertly criticize class injustices, to white males' unconscious desire to possess the supposed sexual power of black males. Nonetheless, it remains that traditional minstrelsy contained numerous racist elements, for white performers mimicked and often romanticized the gestures, dialect, and daily life of African Americans, enslaved African Americans, of whom many of these performers had little knowledge, understanding, and nearly no contact. White minstrelsy extracted humor from a mythologized black experience by illustrating the supposed, quote, combination of simplicity and low cunning, unquote, attributed to African Americans. The form of white minstrelsy became so popular in the later half of the 19th century that 1890s music historian Charles Townsend contended that there was no form of entertainment capable of producing so much innocent fun as a good old minstrel show. The general format of a minstrel show consisted of 17 white actors selected for their skill in replicating the carefree days of plantation slavery. The actors would apply burnt cork and such theater makeup named as quote-unquote mulatto and Indianola to their entire faces, except the lips, as you can see here in this slide, to achieve that authentic, quote, nigger look. And this all comes from a handbook on how to put on a minstrel show from 1890. They would then perform a series of small skits and songs that mimicked the, quote, jigging darkies as seen on the plantation. Some of these early minstrels included Daniel Emmett and the Virginia Minstrels, who were credited with the creation of Dixie, a song that became the unofficial anthem of the Confederate South, and the legendary T.D. Rice. In 1828, Rice developed the infamous character of Jim Crow, a wizened, dilapidated, but ever jovial plantation laborer. The Rice character later became memorialized as the vernacular term for legal segregation, and a visual justification for white supremacists as to why there should be separate laws, transportation, and public accommodations for African Americans and whites. Now, colored minstrelsy, which I'm talking about in terms of where Lewis Wright is performing, differs from the traditional genre in the fact that the actors, musicians, dancers, and singers are all authentic African Americans. While some of these traveling shows stay true to the original genre by romanticizing plantation life, many other shows tend to move away from the buffoonery depicted in white minstrel shows. An African American company such as George's and Hart's, Georgia Minstrels, and most of these minstrel companies find a way to put Georgia in the title to claim some type of authenticity, whether the company is based in Ohio or San Francisco or actually in Georgia. That Southern tradition, it validates them as a true minstrel performance. Georgia and Hart's Georgia Minstrels included Buck and Wing Dancing, precursor to tap dance, a classical musical overture in their evening's program, in addition to more familiar plantation songs like My Old Kentucky Home or Ring Off Coon. And the names are interesting when you're doing this research. Popular troupes between 1890 and the early 1900s included Mahara's Minstrels, where the so-called father of the blues, W.C. Handy, Christopher Handy, first develops his writing skills that will lead to him becoming the forerunner of written blues music. McCabe's Minstrels, Rabbit's Foot's Minstrels, the Georgia graduate students, the Smart Set, the famous Georgia Minstrels, Hicks Georgia Minstrels, remember Georgia's in a lot of title of this. P.G. Lowry's circus band, which was had an unusual place in the fact that they were the band playing for Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey in the midst of the Nadir. Richard Pringles, which Lewis Wright belonged to, the Algie and the A.G. New Orleans Minstrels, as well as finally have to go back to my gender and women's studies roots. the Black Patti Troubadours, which was also seen as a mixture of classical and popular musical styles, but considered as one of these traveling minstrel type groups. The popularity of Black musicals by the end or beginning of the 1900s actually combined the popularity of colored minstrelsy. And these groups afforded African American entertainers with an arena for their artistic creations to develop, as well as needed employment and a place, the ability to travel. Geographic mobility was a great pull for most of these groups. The ability to travel and be paid to do so in prefecture craft in the middle of an era where most African Americans are considered to be no more than subsistence laborers was a great draw for many participants of these groups. By 1910, there were nearly 8,000 African Americans employed as actors, musicians, stagehands, carpenters, managers, and owners, in everything from off-Broadway shows to circuses. Now, ultimately, it's this excitement and pull to the stage that pulled in a young Lewis Wright, who leaves his Chicago home. He's born in Ottawa, Kansas, and migrates to Chicago with his family, and he joins one of the most popular and more well-traveled minstrel groups of the period, Richard and Pringle's Famous Georgia Minstrels. The Famous Georgia Minstrels, as they were known for short, were white-managed by O.E. Richards and C.W. Pringle, and the group was at its height between 1880 to 1910. It consisted of anywhere from 24 to 35 members, including dancers, actors, comedians, who had various headliners. Back to this in a second. Headliners like Billy Kirksands, Billy King, who you see here, and a future founder of the TOBA, which how all this gets started, Sherman H. Dudley, or S.H. Dudley, is a part of Richard Pringle's show. So to give you an example of how the minstrel shows are coalescing and what a vaudeville skit sounds like, I'm going to play a quick clip of Buck and Bubbles. This is a clip from a later recording in the 1930s of one of these comic skits set to the background of popular music. So this is Long Bomb from Bowling Green. In Chicago in in 1905, the Howard Theater in DC, built in 1910, the Booker T. Washington in St. Louis, built in 1912, and the New Standard Theater in Philadelphia in 1914, being among the few. This means that a all-black company, whether black or white managed, who were contracted mostly in white theaters, subject to discrimination as a matter of course. The mainstream season followed from September to June, and African-American companies, especially those performing in rural communities, followed the harvest of the local cash crop. Minstrel and vaudeville comedian Pygmy Markham, who you saw slide up earlier, one of Tobo's feature stars, recalled that in a traveling minstrel review, cast members, quote, put up the show every day and every night they would change town. So every day you're in a different location. By following agricultural labor patterns, traveling reviews hoped that they would arrive in a location at harvest time, when labor is perhaps just been paid and more likely to use that newly earned leisure income on the luxury of professional entertainment. Now, work was available for these performances, but not steady, guaranteed, or protected. How you were paid, if your transportation is paid for up front or taken out of wages, is dependent on your contract. Part of the wages often had to be sent back to family members. Contract, as Dudley writes, when he becomes later part of the founding of the TOVA, a contract could be canceled as the group is traveling midstream from town to town, leaving a group who may have purchased essentials on credit in hopes of being paid by the next performance destitute at the end of the week. So it's entertainment sharecropping, it's entertainment debt beanage. Where you could eat, drink, or seek shelter is governed by the placement of colored and white signs. And unlike later, by the time it gets to the 1930s, where you have something like the Negro Motorist Green Book telling you where you could stay safely in a town, most of these minstrel shows are traveling by social custom of word of mouth. So you may crisscross the country using maybe your own railway car for lodging if your company had enough money to purchase your own car so that you wouldn't have to sit in a segregated seat in the railway. Or you might have a tent show that makes its own camp-like lodgings and pulls its hotels with them. There might be a black town, a hotel in a town that you're going to perform, but more likely there are black residents who open up their homes and schools and turn them into boarding houses for the night. The frequency and distance between jumps or performance locations also added to the mayhem of a performer's life. A small individual act might find work on a three-theater circuit for 9 to 18 weeks, as advertised in the white-managed Southern Vaudeville circuit that was housed in Atlanta, Montgomery, and Pensacola. Or a member of established but fixed troupe, like the Rabbit Switz Minstrels, might play a standard circuit of Tampa, Savannah, and Jacksonville with great regularity. But more likely, you moved every 2 to 3 days across a portion of the state. Wright's group, which is at Richard and Pringles, before they arrived in New Madrid, had a quick Christmas break. They were scheduled in January 1902 to play in Coffeyville, Kansas. And then they moved to Neosha, Carthage, Monet, Fayetteville, Missouri, before ending up all the way, and they're making these zigzags here, and then they're going up here, and they're finally ending in New Madrid. Supposedly, they're supposed to play there by February 25th, 1902. But there is a disturbance that totally changes the way this program is supposed to go. And so the story of Riche and New Madrid. The 24-member Richard and Pringles reached New Madrid on February 15th, 1902. New Madrid at the time was famous in American history for being the site of one of the largest earthquakes in American history in 1812. And it's situated along the banks of the Mississippi River in New Madrid County. It's here at the end of the state. In 1900, it was populated slightly by over 1,400 people. The black population equaled about 18% of that. And most of the African Americans worked on the Mississippi River or in cotton production in the county. The troupe was excited. They were leaving Kansas, and they wrote in to the Freeman, "We are all in Kansas halls and hearty, meeting all kinds of success, and the advance sales alone are being sufficient to warrant us a good business. The SRO, or the standing room only, sign being used more here than usual. We we are soon to be in the state of Missouri. Now, when they hit New Madrid, they come to the center of town, and they leave the railroad station here, and you see the tracks, and they are moving down to the Opera House to perform. And in that morning, and this is a direct quote from one of the St. Louis Republic, on the morning of February 15th at 2:30, we gave a street parade.
Bobby.
And this was generally the music that a minstrel show would have, just announcing or advertising themselves who were coming into the center of town, passing out handbills saying the two performances will be tonight. So they're marching in all their glory, full-on costumes. Well, immediately after the parade at 2:30, Lewis Wright, the victim, accompanied by another member of the company, it was a woman, there were about eight women in the company, were on their way to the Opera House when they were struck by snowballs fired by some young men in town. At any rate, this last volley made Wright angry, and he cursed them, the white men throwing the snowballs at them, and continued on his way to the Opera House. Well, resenting of the uncalled for insult aroused the anger of the young white men, and it was talked from one end of town to the other that afternoon, quote, a nigger dare curse a white man. Now, as the minstrels left the street, the sheriff comes in and he kind of quells the argument, tells the young boys to go home, and he tells the performers to get ready for your show on stage. And so they go to the theater, the Opera House, and they perform their show. In the midst of the performance, they are being taunted with insults, and people are throwing peach pits at them, which is actually a matter of course for a minstrel show. It's very rowdy and ruckus. But then there is this discussion in the mainstream white newspapers that these last volleys of peach pits angers them, and the African-American minstrels pull guns from their pockets and fire upon the audience. They are then whisked away, still allowed to perform that last song, last act, whisked away from the stage. The whole troop is arrested, and then they are, what the quote was, they're sweated to find out who started the shooting. They identify it as Lewis Wright, and they're being held in the jail, waiting for the court sentence to come in the next day, and they're to be investigated and indicted. And of course, Sheriff Stone, unwitted and unaware, can't hold on to the troop, particularly Wright. And he is pulled away from the jail by the mob composed of, quote, men unknown, as the script generally goes. And he's drawn with the troop from the jail and hung just outside of town, actually above Big Prairie Road, which is outside of the image of this, in front of an African-American home. He's left there, he's hung Saturday night, he's left there till Monday morning at 10 a.m., cut down from the tree, put in a box, sent back to his parents in Chicago, cash on delivery, COD. Now, the minstrel group, Richard and Pringles, tells a completely different story in the Indianapolis Freeman, some month later after the murder had occurred. And they protest Wright's lynching as a civil rights offense. And they mention, this is their part of an excerpt, the stain of the most heinous crime that was ever perpetrated upon a traveling organization, and most especially in an organization bearing the reputation of this show, has occurred. We feel greatly humiliated and embarrassed, and our reputation is gone forever. We do not think that the state of Missouri can pay the damage that it has done us, a body of innocent people, and it is well that we were so clear of guilt. As luck would have it, we here have no one that carries a pistol, and the mob found none on us, but we had to suffer just the same. Think, if one of us had shot one white man in New Madrid, there would not be one of us left to tell the tale. And they go on to talk about the dialogue that happens between Sheriff Stone and the whole troop that is then released after the murder of Wright, after some severe beating that happens to the members of the troop. I can't protect you niggers any longer, and you must tell us who fired that shot. If not, I leave you to whatever fate these gentlemen may decide. And that is the discussion that's going back and forth before that he unawarely doesn't know who happens to be in the mob, that does not disguise their faces and picks up, right? Now, when one thinks of racial violence in the post-Reconstruction era, Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi may stand out, but Missouri usually doesn't reach the top of the list. In 1902, there were 85 lynchings total, reported to the Tuskegee Institute, the under the work of Ida B. Wells. There had been, between 1882 to 1968, 122 lynchings in Missouri. 85 of those being African Americans were lynched in Missouri. In New Madrid, there were 3 in a short period of time. Now, as the news wires flash the headline, Negro Minstrel Lynched. This is a colored American in DC, and this is all over the black and news wire, black and white news wires. 2 stories are being told. The first one is of gun-crazy Negroes who shot at an audience in response to a pre-show snowball fight and faced the righteous anger of an endangered white audience. The other story, which is the more realistic one, is that Wright had somehow disrupted the rules of deference with his insult to a white youth while trying to protect a female cast member from these insults and taunts. And the white citizens of New Madrid reacted in outrage. The vicious and violent response of the white mob was clearly a sign to Richard and Pringles that all of their, quote, flashy clothes, and they discussed the truth very negatively before they talk about the murder. Their flashy clothes, their travel opportunities, their employment experience did not give them a right to react in any way when they are harassed by whites. The fact that the lynching took place in front of a colored home also suggests that the action was meant as one to create docility and fear amongst the town's own African-American population. It's in the same year, that 1902, that Sherman H. Dudley becomes a part of Richard and Pringles as a headliner, stage manager, and later the amusement director. Within the next 8 years after his involvement, and this is what he looks like in performance, he was, when I say colored minstrel, he also wore the black face. And this is what he looks like out of black face. Sherman H. Dudley, within 8 years of his headlining with Richard Pringles, develops his own theater circuit that then evolves into a portion of the TOEA. As a former performer, he took not only the stage concerns of lighting, sound, and timing with him, but the need for safety and protection in having their own African-American circuit, even if they're going to work in coalition with white managers. Now, as this is the beginning of research of my overall project, I have a question about how many more minstrels and entertainers are harassed, taunted, and abused, and even killed in the early years of the 1900s. Was there a civil rights outrage toward these particular theater lynchings, or did these lynchings just unfortunately join the hundreds of others of the Nadir? As Dudley becomes a part of Richard and Pringles, how does this incident shape his consciousness for the motivation of the TOEA? Now, while the music mayhem and of black theater life continues on to the 1900s to the 1930s, when the circuit ends, it's the murder headlines of these black performers killed in connection with their traveling circuit. They start to slowly decline. So as Tola is being found in the 1920s, the outright violence declines. And it's this disgraceful affair that is but one horrific chapter in the origin stories of an institution that helps to transmit working class culture throughout the country at the dawn of the 20th century. Thank you.
Shift time periods here. Let me start by picking up on some earlier discussion about another very distant decade in African American history, that being that of the 1990s, when I came to Africana as a master's student. I had the very good fortune of meeting and working with Dr. Harris, who chaired my master's thesis on black soldiers in the Philippines, the rebellion of black soldiers in the Philippines. I was all fired up and ready to go teach high school, and I was going to make revolution, cultural revolution. I was heavy into cultural nationalism and 7 principles, And I had them all lined up in my classroom and found out by the end of the year that I was not going to survive as a high school teacher in PG County. Well, actually before the year ended, actually by mid-year, right around the time when I could apply to the PhD program in the history department at Cornell, where I am very fortunate to say that I was the first PhD student in history to work with Dr. Harris. And this early 90s was a period of a lot of elevated expectations because the Afrocentric movement was very, very powerfully influencing discussions about curriculum. Black bookstores were popping up in neighborhoods. Veterans of the Black Power and Civil Rights movements, many of the rank and file folks were often people working in the bookstores. Study groups were popping up. So I was told about Africana really in that context. And so when I came back, the person who encouraged me to go to graduate school was a bookstore owner named Gerald Shaka in Rochester, New York, who owned a bookstore called Kitabu Kingdom. And I promised him that if I ever got a PhD, I would write about this group that he said started this holiday called Kwanzaa, called Us. And he warned me it could get a little difficult. And I wish he would have told me a little bit more because I didn't know exactly what I was in store for. But in that context, I worked with Professor Harris on writing the first overview of that group, the US organization, which I also am pretty confident in saying that that was part of an early part of a wave of books on Black power organizations. So the decade of the 90s is also the first wave of books that talk about Black power purely as a historical moment. There are lots of books that were sort of statements and declaratives of the period. So I'm glad to have participated in that aspect of historiography with one of the true masters in analyzing and understanding African-American historiography, Dr. Harris. Well, in the process of writing about the US organization, I gave considerable thought to this question of cultural revolution, which is what the aim of the US organization was. I was somewhat of an advocate while I was doing this work, so the critiques that came to me came from really being very close to my subject, sort of different from this idea of distance being the real basis for criticism. Sometimes when you're right in the face of the funk, it takes on a different kind of character and real meaning for you when you face contradiction. And so I started to think about not just cultural revolution as something that comes from a big idea, but something that builds off of structures that are already in place. And so as I thought about music, I was interested in this idea. The last chapter of the book in the US book is called In the Face of Funk, Black Music and the Arts of War. So I'm already getting back to my musical roots. And then now I'm interested in writing on black music and black bands. Just to start off here, Professor Harris and Professor Turbrook Penn in the Columbia Guide to African American History since 1939 highlight the contradictory dimensions of recent developments in African American history, and that contradiction being the appearance of great levels of progress at the same time simultaneous with all kinds of new and even worsening challenges. Ascending educational achievements coupled with, for instance, exploding incarceration rates, the growth of black middle class and college graduates alongside the expansion of the black poor, et cetera, et cetera. Hence the title of that section, Raising the Questions of the Glass, Half Empty or Half Full. And there's a way that music has been used to talk about periods in history. The jazz age, I just received a text building on Perrow's comment that in Perrow's book, I'm now part of what they call the hip-hop, you know, historians. Even though actually my musical grounding is a little earlier than that, that's funk, but we're gonna work on that, you know, revision for the next edition. All right, so for the past 10 years or so, I've been researching Dayton, Ohio as a musical epicenter that had a special impact on popular music And so, especially in the genre known as funk. Now, because I focused on Dayton, Ohio, I've been accused of being from Dayton, Ohio, actually. And I'm not, okay? I'm from Rochester, New York. But musically, I grew up on funk, especially bands that came from Dayton, Ohio. And I was, as I read People's History by the great, late great historian Howard Zinn, he said one should be very explicit about your investment in a given project. So let me just forewarn you, this slide that I'm going to have to show here. Okay, thank you.
Over. Okay, so.
That's all right, we'll get back to that. No, I'm not so sure if that slide, yeah, yes it is, it's coming. Okay, I don't know if you can guess who up there ended up being the nerdy historian rather than the rock star. But my mentor was Rick James, I'll leave it at that. My first mentor. Now, when you make a claim about a town being an epicenter, that is a quantitative claim, I was told. So most people I have to convince that Dayton was, in fact, an epicenter of funk bands. So I think I will proceed to do that by playing clips of songs from Dayton bands. Roger and Zapp are among a few from Dayton, Ohio. Additionally, there were countless Dayton bands that did not attain recording contracts but maintained a local following. In spite of these developments, scholarly acknowledgement of Dayton as a funk epicenter is beginning to emerge. Also, memoirs that are written by, independent memoirs by archivists, local archivists and historians are documenting, had already documented a lot of this before I started to get into looking at this. I was interested because my three favorite bass players all came from Dayton bands. I wanted to know what was in the water. Maybe I could drink some of it and play better. Marshall Jones of the Ohio Players, Marvin Craig from Lakeside, and Mark Adams from Slave, my three favorite bass players. Biases, though, favoring big cities hinder the notion of positioning a relatively small Midwestern city, Dayton, as on par with New York, Chicago, Memphis, Detroit, New Orleans, and other cities revered as centers of black music and popular culture. African Americans in Dayton comprised over one-third of a population less than 200,000 during the latter half of the 1970s. Dayton is a city shaped by the spatial politics of race. By the World War II years, not only did 80% of African Americans in Dayton live in West Dayton, in that river, the Miami River running right through the city, dividing it by its east and west side is really the real border there. 80% of blacks lived in West Dayton, and these migrants who came to Dayton, mostly in the 30s and 40s, were usually coming from regions in the South and the lower Midwest, were far along in the institutionalization of a new Northern identity by the time of funk bands starting to emerge. But West Dayton was and remains to this day in large measure synonymous with Black Dayton. From the World War II years through the 1970s, Black Dayton's working class found an abundant and relatively high wage availability of employment at McCall's Printing, Frigidaire, General Motors, Chrysler, the Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, and a number of service sector businesses. Though many of these jobs were located outside of the black residential community, the income earned by black workers supported a thriving entertainment district located on West 5th Street in Dayton, with numerous businesses, clubs, and taverns. Over the course of the post-World War II era, different styles of black music, jazz, blues, rhythm and blues, soul, and funk, resounded along the blocks of West Dayton. Music was a primary facet of home sphere institutions in Dayton. And this is where I would like to see the analysis move from the tendency in cultural studies to, you know, memorize lyrics and analyze lyrics as text to us to think more about the political economy out of which music circulates. And some of these home sphere institutions, of course, we know about the church, but important to this story also, public schools, parks, and recreation centers. Music in this context was not merely a cultural product of community, it functioned as a primary social currency, interlocking families, households, to public spaces in diverse segments of the black home sphere. I'm not talking about a Dayton exceptionalism here when I say this. We can follow this story because of the line of groups that have contracts. But this is the story of Buffalo, it's the story of Pittsburgh, it's the story of Toledo. It's a story of many small and medium-sized cities that had, at a certain point, a relatively high wage-earning working class at a certain point in time. Many of these places are overlooked. Dayton's first nationally renowned funk band, the Ohio Players, punctuated the height of their commercial achievement with a succession of top-selling albums during the 70s. Skin Tight, Fire, Honey, Contradiction, Angel, all the way through there. Long before the mid-1970s, the Players had a well-established musical force in Dayton and the Midwest. Formed in the late 50s as the Ohio Untouchables, the band changed its name to the Ohio Players in 1965 and went through numerous personnel changes. Let me back up here. Kind of got off. Now, That's the earlier feature of the players, of course, in the 50s, so you see the transition from process to Afro. Of course, that's a longer discussion that we can have folks, you know, partake in later on. But in any case, they were the Ohio players because they can play, but they weren't just players because they can play. They were playing. During the initial years, the Untouchables groups, the Untouchables, the Ohio Untouchables, lead vocalist and guitarist is blues extraordinaire Robert Ward. The departure of Ward led to the group's identity toward that of a self-contained band. They experienced what I call LSF, lead singer fatigue, which is a byproduct of the origins of LSF is LSE, lead singer ego. See, there you go. That's a consistent pattern in the history of the black band. Okay, still going on today. So, by the heyday years of the 70s, there's a small group of them that maintain their identity as a band, the Ohio Players. In the 1950s, when Robert Ward came to Dayton from his hometown, Luthersville, Georgia, he was following the path of fellow blues guitarist Sammy and Earl Reed. These are pictures I took of them when I went to Dayton, and they actually gave me some blues lessons in this house that they would use to practice in. The Reed brothers were from Noonan, Georgia, just 13 miles from Luthersville, and came to Dayton roughly a year before Ward did. The Reed Brothers' down-home blues sound took Dayton by storm and expanded musical venues for black musicians in the area. In so doing, they mentored many musicians in Dayton, including would-be Ohio Players bassist Marshall Jones. That's him wearing the turban there, who played with the Reed Brothers after leaving high school in 1960. Thereafter, Jones went on to play with Ward's Untouchables, but remained one of the few members that is one of the early core that stayed with the Ohio Players throughout. Now, we recently lost one of the most important voices of the Ohio Players and in funk music, period. So don't apologize for not knowing who he is now, but then hereafter, you know, I'm going to quiz you if I run into you. And this is none other than Leroy Sugarfoot Bonnie. Leroy Bonner was a guitarist from Hamilton, which is just outside of Dayton, Ohio. There's an argument as to whether or not Hamilton is greater Dayton or greater Cincinnati. But Roger Troutman from Zapp and Sugarfoot both claim Dayton, so Dayton may be in the lead on that debate. He joined the Players as a guitarist, and after Robert Ward led the band. As a teenager, Sugarfoot learned to play the harmonica and guitar. He was originally nicknamed, because he was so young, just 14, when he dropped out of school to play with a group of older musicians. His nickname was Tenderfoot, and the group members of the Blues Bees performed at a lot of local venues in Hamilton and Cincinnati. Bonner's lady friend, who apparently was older, however, deemed Sugarfoot a more appropriate moniker. Still in his late teens, he moved to Cincinnati, where his musical education expanded to include jazz influences from artists who also lived in Cincinnati and frequently performed there, especially Wilbur Longmire and Wes Montgomery, who was from Indianapolis, but performed a lot in Cincinnati. Sugarfoot, because he couldn't compete with Robert Ward's blues style, emphasized his jazz licks, and he has his own special style of scatting and playing octaves that was really trademarked to his guitar playing. So he joined the group to be a guitar player. But remember what I'm talking about here with this LSF. You may not have heard of this person, but very important to the funk history. When the Ohio Players began recording with Westbound Records, their lead singer was Walter Junior Morrison. Comes one of the most important songwriters in funk history. He wrote One Nation Under a Groove, Aqua Boogie, Knee Deep, for Parliament Funkadelic. When the Ohio Players got a better deal with Mercury Records in 72, the small boutique label owner, Armin Belladium, of Westbound Records appealing to LSE. Said, Junior, come on over here. You need to go solo. After all, you are the front man. They can't do anything without you. So what happens is Junie stays with Westbound. The Ohio Players, without their lead singer, goes to Mercury Records. And that's where the guitarist, jazz guitarist, is pretty much ordered by the leader to now sing. And so Sugarfoot, when he's one of the most important vocal stylists, and that's when he brings his memory of the blues and gospel. So many funk singers all say, ow, in the song. Right, with Lionel Richie, ow. With the Commodores, where there's Larry Dotson, the Barclays, ow. Well, I asked Sugarfoot, where did ow come from? And he said, well, that's just what I say when a pretty lady walks by. So the imprimatur of the group really is with these changes, but it's really a group that resisted or had multiple experiences with lead singers, pretty much trying to redirect the group in another direction. Members of the Ohio Players set the precedent of residing in Dayton at the height of their fame. And that's what really, when people ask me, well, why did these bands in Dayton, if the city is such a small city and all these things working against it, why did all these bands become nationally renowned? And it's because the Players, their parochialism actually ended up being their strength. The Players resided in Dayton through the height of their most impressive years as recording artists. They made it easy to mentor younger bands, groups like Fazo, Slave, and numerous others. At one point were mentored through the process of getting a recording contract by the Players. The band worked in tandem with other community institutions essential to the training of musicians, one of the most important being area high schools. Unlike the Ohio Players, a subsequent wave of Dayton bands did not have long professional music careers prior to receiving initial recording contracts. A significant number of them were either recent graduates or still attending high school during the mid-70s and received formal and informal musical training in Dayton's public schools. The church has been sort of noted as a preeminent institution in the development of countless luminaries in African American music across denominations, of course. But schools, public schools, however, were a very important element in this story. And if you look at the memoirs of numerous musicians from this period, they all talk about access to music education at a very early age. Even Rick James, Fred Wesley, Maurice White, Prince in Minneapolis, and a host of others learned how to play instruments and participated in school bands, choirs, and studied music theory in school, sometimes as early as the elementary level. Roosevelt High School, Dunbar High School, Roth High School, Jefferson High School, and others in the Dayton area all had extensive music programs. Now, I'm going to cut some of this short because I know we're time is tight, but I have been lucky also to interview many musicians, many music teachers. And they have a different view of the policies of busing, the attempts, policy issues around integration that transformed the whole kind of networks that they had worked to establish. So Charles Spencer, who was the music teacher at Roosevelt High School, who taught voice to so many of the singers that came out of Dayton, when I interviewed him, I remember him saying, then that integration thing came. And I said, well, what do you mean, sir? He said, well, all these things I used to do with students was based on living in a neighborhood with them. So I could chaperone them to play at clubs. I could do this, that, and the other. And now I'm being moved as a teacher to a school outside the neighborhood. Also, the time that students could spend in extracurricular activities diminished. So he had a view, and I found that view replicated. Now, I didn't get the sense that there's a romanticized view of Jim Crow, you know, in Dayton, but what you're getting is a sense that the policy execution was one directional. So they weren't talking about the resources that in the black schools, they were often being talked about as schools that were at a sort of deficit, right? And one aspect of Roosevelt and Dunbar High Schools was that they had teachers with PhDs because of the limited opportunities. Some of the older teachers had PhDs from places like Howard University. So there's a sense of nostalgia, but I don't think it should be dismissed. I think it needs to be engaged as we think about not just sort of a simplistic notion of integrationism, is it good? Is nationalism, separatism good? But let's critically look at the policy measures and did they actually even come close to achieving that goal? I want to just give you an example of the musical expression of arts education in popular music. The drummer for the Ohio Players, his name is known as Diamond. In fact, if you say his whole name and date, I don't think you people will know who you're talking about. If you say Diamond, they know that's the drummer. That's the second large afro there with shades on, next to Marvin Pierce, the trumpet player. Now, James Diamond, since he was in his elementary school years, played in school marching bands. And if you just want to get a sense for the continuities, I often get asked, well, if these students had all this music education, how did it come out aesthetically in the music? I want you to listen carefully to this intro. No other ballad starts off like this by a drummer. And it is one of, I think, one of the most powerful songs by Ohio Players. I might have to play it twice so you can get it, because it's so quick. What balance there? Hold on. You're not ready for this. Listen to this again. Hold on time. Listen to this.
One day, child, I'll have grace into your life.
And so, the training, the horn sections, the way that the ensemble of the self-contained band is prominent during this period, I think is most appropriately linked to this concept of funk. Because funk has so many contradictions in it, right? You feel it, and we also use it as a negative connotation. Sometimes you're in a funky situation. And if hip-hop is used to talk about deindustrialization and the decline of these institutions, and if soul and R&B are linked to the civil rights movement that brought about many of the changes that didn't have the kind of longevity that was anticipated, then I think funk is an important transition point in which the artistic expression of a relatively empowered black working class is an important part of the cultural history that we can engage to this day. Now, lastly, let me end. I'm off script now. Let me end by saying there was a point that Piero made about young people today engaging history and engaging the past. I want to challenge part of that to say they engage it sometimes without knowing. How many of us have heard young people say when they hear a song, we know the original, and they've heard it, and they think that's the song, but we say, no. That's the Ohio Players. That's the Temptations. That's this group. So I think that when thinking about this, there are opportunities here. The 1970s and 80s, funk was reintroduced to latter-day audiences vis-a-vis the frequent use of sampling in hip-hop, especially during the 1990s. The bass lines and breakbeats of Dayton funk found new life in a form restructured to fit the auditory preferences of a new group of listeners. The presence of funk in contemporary music continues to this day. The old school groove emanating from garages and basements in Dayton and other lands of funk
We might want to think about this differently. Maybe they're not reaching out to the past. I want to get mystical here. Maybe the beat imposes itself on us, reaching into the future, making its presence felt in new technologies and new generations of music listeners. The sonic calculus, perfected by James Brown, Sly Stone, and 70s funk bands, is a force shaped by the historic struggle for Black community in multiple contexts. Even a slice of a funk song, sampled and reformulated, contains the visions, labors, creativity, and struggles of everyday people like those who made Dayton a veritable land of funk. Thank you.
Good afternoon. When I first visited Cornell as a job candidate in 2008, Professor Harris was out of town. And so I didn't get to meet him and be interviewed by him on my visit. But from the time that I arrived on campus, he's certainly been a very valued colleague and very supported and deeply appreciated by me. I am academically appreciative to Professor Harris for a range of reasons, but most recently for the remarkable work that he's done on Dr. Martin Luther King and related monuments, the DC monument, and to an extent from his position as National Historian of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity, Incorporated. I have learned from this work, particularly because I and appreciate this work, particularly because I'm doing work on monuments and memorials related to figures such as Mary McLeod Bethune and Rosa Parks. Professor Harris and I also are connected as Ford Fellows. He's a veteran Ford Fellow, in fact, and it was just really wonderful to be able to attend the 50th anniversary celebration of the Ford Fellows Program last September in Irvine, California, and to make the journey from Cornell along with Professor Harris and art historian Cheryl Finley. Thirdly, I really valued interlocutions with Professor Harris here in Africana, primarily from the position of being director of undergraduate studies, including for a time under his administration as director, and then also in dialogue because he too has been a recent undergraduate director and has done such remarkable work in helping to institute the revisions for our major. I want to dedicate my comments today to David Van Leer, my former colleague from UC Davis, who passed on very sadly this past Wednesday. A lot of us are very shocked and saddened by his loss. David is, in fact, an alumnus of Cornell. He received his BA, MA, and PhD degrees from Cornell University. So I give this talk in his honor today. It is both a privilege and a pleasure to hear such fine discussions today and to have an opportunity to ponder the long histories of Black performance and civil rights struggle. Situated at opposite poles on the historical spectrum, in periods just as the legally sanctioned Jim Crow system was emerging on the one hand, and in the post-civil rights period after its decline on the other, they are a reminder that performance is political. The 1981 Pulitzer Prize-winning A Soldier's Play by Charles Fuller is set during World War II and begins with a haunting and mystifying utterance by Sergeant Vernon Waters that they'll still hate you. We learn as the play continues that Waters, a veteran of World War I, had finally grasped an understanding that his own father's obsession with lessons on how to speak, dress, walk, and talk a certain way to gain white respectability have been in vain. The sobering truth is that regardless of putting the proverbial best foot forward, the fact of blackness is insurmountable in a social context conditioned by white supremacy and premised on a deep-seated view of blacks as inferior. Professor Scott cites Leon Littwack's Trouble in Mind, Black Southerners in the Age of Jim Crow in her study, and I want to draw on it myself, too, to throw into relief this chilling observation that during the late 19th century, upwardly mobile blacks who were increasingly part of a professional class and who dressed well and appeared to be privileged socially and economically were the especial targets of forms of intimidation and even violence in the South. This was a phenomenon that belied the logic of black communities that linked upward mobility and social advancement to such forms of respectable self-representation, when the truth was that the better one dressed, the worse one was treated, and the more likely one was to be perceived as uppity. And this kind of goes along with some of Professor Kevin Gaines' research as well. The main title of Marvin McAllister's 2003 book, get this right, White People Do Not Know How to Behave at Entertainments Designed for Ladies and Gentlemen of Color, William Brown's, African and American Theater, is provocative as taken from a sign that Brown, a pioneer in the world of Manhattan black theater in the early 19th century, posted as a result of white rioters in 1822 who were increasingly incensed by his forward-looking vision and attest to how incendiary Euro-Americans found notions of blacks as legitimate cultural claimants to be. It is sobering that Barack Obama's legitimacy as an American citizen and fitness for the office of the presidency, the highest in the land, has repeatedly been called into question, notably within political movements such as the Tea Parties and the Birthers. His extraordinary achievements even fuel much of the criticism and inflict accusations among his critics that he is too arrogant or too elite. Lewis Wright was a black-based minstrel performer and part of a performance tradition grounded in a narrative of plantation nostalgia and romance that recurrently recast the myth of a happy slave, with some exceptions. The irony was that members of his audience reacted with hatred and hostility less associated with the myths of antebellum white paternalism and more reflective of the precarious social positioning of blacks around the turn of the century who had increasingly become the targets of rioting and racial violence over the past decade. And I must say that the mention of the Indianapolis Freeman in this discussion as a news source that helps communicate the truth about what really happened to Lewis Wright stands out to me, given that it proves yet again how tirelessly George Knox, the grandfather of John Knox, who's a friend of my mother's, worked as a journalist beginning in the 19th century, and the difference that his landmark publication consistently made, and is just one illustration of the significance of the Knox dynasty as a political force in the state of Indiana, in Indianapolis specifically, and the African-American context more broadly. It is helpful that Professor Scott draws on a range of African-American news archives, so I just really appreciate the composition of the project at that level as well. What Professor Scott discussion compellingly shows is how much the emergent black minstrel stage, in spite of its perceived recalcitrance in the black cultural imaginary and the innocuousness of the content of its actual performance routines, registered as an indicator of black progress and success and seemed threatening to audiences for the doors to economic and social mobility that it conceivably opened to its performers. Lewis Wright's horrific lynching accorded with the logic that critics of the time made clear, that black economic progress and attainment, not rape, as so popularly believed about black men as a category, was far more often the hidden, if typically unacknowledged, rationale for lynching of blacks during the postbellum era. Professor Scott, I would love to hear more about the primary background factors that you feel made a difference in the face of this social context and about how you feel this case can help to expand our understanding of the history of lynching and what some perceive to be as continuing and diverse manifestations in the contemporary era. You know, we can think of the character Radio Raheem
from Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing, can think of the True to Life case of Jordan Davis especially, notably because the music of the car was blaring too loudly. This discussion forces us to take a more complex and grounded look at the plight of Black minstrel performers around the turn of the century and to link it more intimately to the continuing struggle for civil rights and to also think about it more ostensibly in relation to labor history. As Ohio native and Nobel laureate Toni Morrison's narrator memorably and provocatively remarks in the 1970 novel The Bluest Eye, which is set in her hometown, Lorain, Ohio, a certain cohort of Black women, quote, go to land-grant colleges, normal schools, and learn how to do the white man's work with refinement, teacher education to instruct Black children in obedience, music to soothe the weary master and entertain his blunted soul. Here, they learn the rest of the lesson begun in these soft houses with porch swings and pots of bleeding heart, how to behave. The careful development of thrift, patience, high morals, and good manners. In short, how to get rid of the funkiness, the dreadful funkiness of passion, the funkiness of nature, the funkiness of the wide range of human emotions. Wherever it erupts, this funk they wipe away. Where it crusts, they dissolve it. Wherever it drips, flowers, or clings, they find it and fight it until it dies. They fight it all the way to the grave. The laugh that is too loud, the enunciation a little too round, the gesture a little too generous. They hold their behind in for fear of a sway too free. When they wear lipstick, they never cover the entire mouth for fear of lips too thick. And they worry, worry, worry about the edges of their hair. Susan Willis has drawn on this passage and examined eruptions of funk in Toni Morrison's literature. Particularly in light of a link to Ohio, I think that this poignant passage might serve as a useful gateway into some dialogue about the music movement that Professor Brown has been analyzing, which, in the emphasis on a Midwestern context, moves beyond an emphasis on the urban epicenters that have been conventionally invoked and celebrated as the centers of Black popular culture production, including the production of music, registering a more diverse and inclusive geographical context. This is a strategy that seems to be poised at the vanguard of a movement to increasingly explore geographies in various regions that have been marginal and excluded, and that have nevertheless been tremendously important in shaping the history of Black music. Professor Brown's discussion is revelatory and thought-provoking on a number of other levels. I have just a few observations I'd like to put on the table. I think that it builds upon the work that pioneering scholars and theorists of music such as Mark Anthony Neal have done related to soul as a genre and promotes a more inclusive and complex historicization of the linkages between Black music and politics in the contemporary era, illustrating how various Black artists and even many who came of age prior to the era of hip-hop produced a viable art in the shadows of deindustrialization, and that both reflected and intimately shaped the political consciousness in the African-American context and the U.S. mainstream more broadly. I am also intrigued by how he indicates the rise of the synthesizer and drum machines that shaped the decline of this genre, even as the phenomenon of sampling had begun to expose newer generations to it. I am also interested in the educational subtext of the talk, given the mention of how many of the artists that might be categorized in the funk genre received musical education in school that helped to make their artistic expression possible in the first place. This project is exciting too, because the Africana Center is a department where scholars and students have studied various music traditions. Most immediately, I think, of the 2010 thesis on Afropunk by Aaron Thompson, for which I served as an advisor. I also think of my own experience in researching writing about Southern rap and New Orleans-based producers in the last chapter of my first book, a chapter titled Gangsters and Players in the Dirty South, precisely because their stories seem to be so marginal and neglected in mainstream narratives of hip-hop that until recent years typically devalued and excluded Southern artists and producers. I want to end by describing one of my own encounters with some of the practitioners of this important Black music tradition. A few years ago, my friend Tangela Giles and I attended a concert in Sacramento that included Alexander O'Neill, Sherelle, and Lakeside, whose audience consisted of mostly African Americans. Lakeside was the highlight, and the audience seemed to be dazzled by their instrumental talent. As we left the fairgrounds, we, along with many of those who were leaving, commented on how refreshing it had been that evening to listen to the music of a live band, and that we had just witnessed what amounted to good entertainment while seeing Black music legends in the process. It seemed that the concert had led many on the peaceful walk out to the parking lot at Cal Expo to reflect what increasingly seemed to amount to times gone by in the world of Black music, to reflect on what increasingly amounted to times gone by in the world of Black music, back to an era that many of us experienced day to day as teens as we watched Donnie Simpson on Video Soul and the unseen DJ Alvin Jones on Video Vibrations. The late night show, Midnight Love, made up the other leg of this trilogy of shows that brought this music to life for an entire generation and whose important message and movement has been lost in translation and that is being given the serious and sustained consideration that it deserves by Professor Brown. It is noteworthy even that the internet has played a role in providing information about groups that are not as readily given television and news exposure and coverage in today's popular mainstream. Certain websites, such as Black Celebrities Who Died with Little or No Fanfare, have featured updates on the lives and careers of these artists that many of us continue to admire and care about. Alice Walker, in her excavation of the legacy of Zora Neale Hurston, offered a sobering reminder of the necessity of respecting the valuable literary and cultural legacies we have and not allowing them to be lost or forgotten. I am thankful and inspired that Professor Brown is doing such valuable work to help preserve and teach about the legacy of Black Funk.
All right, we have about 10 minutes left for questions and answers. What I want to do is to really first reframe two of the questions that I heard Professor Richardson raise in her response. So I wanted to follow up with Professor Scott and find out if you could quickly help us link this issue of lynching and entertainment to the contemporary context.
It's actually a question I'm just beginning. That I'm just beginning to grapple with. In looking at the origins of the TOVA, it's mostly, it's discussed in many biographical discussions of the people who performed on the circuit, and it's also discussed in terms of the background of looking at the main contributor, or African-American contributor, S.H. Dudley. But I have a question in terms of exploring these origins. Is it just the economic source of the factor of segregation that allows for the circuit to be created? What's the motivation, the social functions of the circuit? And so when I found, and let me give credit, one of my undergraduate students found just the quote, Negro minstrel lynched. And then she neglected to tell me what newspaper or what date or anything like that. But she did that part of the research. And so when I actually started to search it, Lewis Wright comes up because he is followed in both the mainstream and African-American newspapers. But then there is a lynching in 1911 in A.G. Fields' minstrels in New Orleans. There's the beginnings of a race riot in Arkansas in 1907 involving these performers. And so I was really starting to see that this trend between racial violence leading to the need to have these what are protected spaces, even in the midst of segregation, is something that I can follow up on. And so I kind of see the connection, or even what Scott was talking about, when you're kind of troubling the tensions between integration and segregation being a Black and white issue, but in these protected, segregated spaces, the decline in violence happens in terms of once the circuit gets started and you actually have Black and white managers working together, but they have their own cars, they have their own theaters. And before, motion pictures kills vaudeville altogether, they have this relatively protected space. There's a lot of negativity involved in that in terms of pay scale or lack thereof that occurs. But this violence theme is a trope that I'd like to see kind of follow through. You see, what does it really mean
we'll talk about contemporary levels of violence and how does that flow into theater. Not just the production on stage or film or music, but behind the scenes, the economic production of what goes into these artistic creations.
And Professor Brown, so I wanted to follow up also on this question of education. I was shocked when you played that drum open. And I'm like, wow, that is funky. You don't think about that coming out of, you know, out of schools. And so, you know, what aspect of socialization or education was occurring in these black schools that allowed the funk to sort of live when the students got out of that process?
Sure. Well, one facet of music education that was really big there was the prevalence of talent, competitive talent shows. And so Roosevelt High School, Dunbar High School, these all-black schools were struggling for resources. And one way that music teachers would raise money for equipment, raise money, is to have talent shows. And these talent shows in Dayton, Ohio, and many other cities, as I would say, elevated to the same level as a concert that of major recording artists. So a lot of the bands that received recording contracts had names beforehand as local artists. So Slave was a group called the Young Mystics. Used to compete against the Imperials. And there's, I've done over 80 transcribed oral history interviews over the past 10 years. And the descriptions of these events sort of gives rise to this idea of there being a real competitive ethos that at a certain point even rivals sports competition in these high schools. So that's one aspect of, so when I think about arts education, I'm trying to expand the way we think about it. So it's not simply just, you know, music instruction in schools, because so much of it is happening outside of the schools, with music teachers also acting and women, a lot of women managers, operating as chaperones and mentoring young people, because they're in a lot of very difficult, dangerous places for young people to be when they're performing at local nightclubs. So I'm trying to think of arts education as, of course, you have it in the class, but you have these informal structures of music education that are outside of the classroom that I'm discovering in the process here.
Can I insert my question because it sort of follows up on that. It just occurs to me, like, the socioeconomics of what's available to musicians, two fictional things and one real life thing. It's one, you know, the HBO series Treme has Antoine Baptiste, the character known, you know, sometimes referred to as the seventh left trombone player in New Orleans, taking a job teaching music at a middle school or high school. Then there's, you know, the movie Drumline, and then a real life example, Pharoah Sanders was actually a high school band teacher in Little Rock, Arkansas at one point. So I think just in terms of who are the teachers in these schools and where do they come from, what's their motivation, what's their background, and what were their aspirations, and how do they pass those on to younger people? I think that's a really intriguing question. So I just throw that out there.
A number of them went to HBCUs. Some had doctoral degrees in music. I mean, these were people who were multidimensional. Funk is what came out of their working with students. But these are people who can, you know, conduct an orchestra, right? They know classical music, jazz. And so a lot of these things that were being invented were really their compromises they would make with the students in terms of finding ways to get them motivated to perform. But I'm talking about a highly trained group of educators who don't regard arts education as something on the side. So if you wanted to sing in the choir at Roosevelt High School, you had to take Mr. Spencer's class on music theory. So I have all these testimonies, lead singer from Lakeside, lead singer from this group, saying, Mr. Spencer's the one who taught me the complexities of harmony. But they could not get their shine on, if you will, in public without paying the dues of passing his classes in theory.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to follow up a bit on that regarding actual musical education, but slightly different version of education maybe. So you talked about kind of the effects that the small town has had temporarily, you know, on it today, and then also you can say nationally. But did I understand you correctly? You said you were doing your master's was on black military and
rebellious black soldiers in the Philippines.
Okay, so I'm asking this is sort of a big selfish question, but I'm working on hip hop in Japan specifically. But recently, I've been looking a lot at the roots of that. And so what I found actually is that obviously there were a lot of people who picked up information and stuff like that. So they got their jazz education through black players. Mm-hmm. But obviously there was a certain point, say in the 30s and 40s, where access to any kind of American, black or otherwise, was not possible because we're about to go to war. So the sort of proxy for that was people from the Philippines. And people from the Philippines have always, the Philippines has always had sort of a reputation for, if you want to do black music, Philippines, that's where they're from. And so I wanted to ask you, especially in the funk, there's some groups from the 70s, like Black Buster and all these other groups, that, they're just amazing. And, and so I was maybe gonna, I'd like to ask you about what sort of effect do you think maybe some of these groups may have had in the Philippines? Because, I think a lot of post-war in Japan, a lot of the education, musical education, came from people who, some people were musicians, James Brown came over in 1973, but before that, there were a lot of people who were just saying, they were at the clubs and said, hey guys, play this, no more like that, okay, good, here's a tip. So I'm kind of wondering maybe what sort of effect that black military people may have had in the Philippines, a more global question, I guess.
Oh, sure, no, it's a profound impact, and in fact, you have, there's a story that Lakeside tells where they're going on tour. Lakeside's with Solar Records and they go and play in Nigeria. And, they have their hit records, they have their show. Well, there was a B-side called Keep On Moving Straight Ahead. It was just a song on the album, it's kind of a filler song. It was a huge hit in Lagos just because of the way that disc jockeys at that time, both in the US and abroad, had a lot of autonomy in terms of what they played. So you had the capacity for regional hits that don't chart in the same way. And so this song, they had to learn their own song to play the concert, and they said everybody knew the words to it. I've also heard about the success of groups like Shalimar abroad. Far beyond, we have, a lot of the songs by Shalimar, Make This a Night to Remember, but these are hits sometimes bigger, and as a result, so many artists have not gotten adequately compensated. So this, the way I kind of get into the story is really trying, the whole pursuit of finding the money, right? Because distributions rights are different for all these other channels that artists go abroad and discover, right? You have this recent case with the artist, out of Detroit, right, who's this huge star in South Africa and never knew it, never saw a dime, right? And it's just a few accidents of history that allow this consciousness of that. So I think that there is a dimension to that that's a long story about the global dimension that we talk about.
Professor Brown, I was struck by something that you said as you were playing much of the soundtrack of my high school and college years. Including when I was in Professor Penn's class at Morgan State in the 70s. But one of the things you said was, the impact of music education and, as you play the drum roll to I Want to Be Free. And it reminded me of something that I ran across some years ago, actually in a seminary article. I think it was written by a scholar by the name of David Hall at the University of Oklahoma Law School called The Six Fallacies of the Brown Decision. And one of the fallacies he highlights was the lack of consideration for the way in which black public schools provided a certain type of discrete and core and educational contributions that were not accounted for. And he makes the argument that the thrust should have been less not for integration immediately from the standpoint of access, But how do you strengthen, for instance, Black public education? And so I think, you know, what you said was just so on point.
Well, I appreciate it. I think really what it gets to is us asking the question that we need to revisit this. What does integration really mean? Right. Okay, I think that hasn't been resolved because our notion of integration is tied to a certain number of specific policy measures, right? That, I mean, if integration is this ideal, I think we need to tease that out and be creative about what that really means. I don't think those in Dayton who lament what happened in Dayton are people that say they want to be told they can't go to another school. So they don't like to be told, but they didn't at the same time want to see the dismantling. So the 1974 Supreme Court decision is called the Dayton decision, Dayton 1 and Dayton 2. And that's the decision that allows for integration plans to cover the entirety of a region, a district, and beyond in terms of the remedy. And that was a Dayton case that led to the closure of Roosevelt High School.
So we have time for one more question.
Mr. Scott.
There's a question in the front of the room.
It's okay, yeah. Go ahead.
You want to talk?
I'll ask it later, go ahead.
All right.
We'll get ready for the name.
Yeah. All right.
Thank you, sir. It's not really a question. It's a sense of impact. I've asked myself the question when I'm showering, why is it that I can sing songs that I learned in eighth grade? Mm-hmm. I had a Black music teacher, and the songs that she taught us were European songs. And for some reason, I can remember all of the words of those songs. Now, during that time, the music that was actually made by us Black young men were doo-wop songs. Mm-hmm. So that was the contrast against the European songs. Mm-hmm. But I'm just saying this to say that the schools, at least at one time, in Black schools, in the 50s, mid-50s, really tried to, speak of integration, tried to teach us a way of sensing a culture that we would be able to use outside of our Black culture, so to speak. We kind of restrained from that, but we went through it. And I think the music that we produced was the counteraction to what was happening in terms of our education, because it was a European-type education. And that isn't who we really were, so we created our own sense of song. I noticed that during the period in which music seemed to have a gap, and that's when hip-hop came along, the funk that you have been talking about. I remember that era very, very, very well. But I also remember that there was a gap following that funk. Now, in the hip-hop in the 80s, at least I remember, the dancing or spinning on your head and so forth in New York City, came about during that time when the music was beginning to change. And I remember asking some young people here at Cornell and when I was teaching art here about the music in terms of they were hip-hop students. And they said that the reason that they make the music they make is because somehow the history of what was before, like the doo-wop type of music, was not something that they really got. Now, they hear it, but it was not a smooth transition from the hip-hop into the music that they actually made themselves. I was wondering, what is your response on the connections and the disconnects to the music over the period from the 50s into the 60s, the rock and roll, and then into the period that we have today?
Okay, now you said a lot of interesting things. One point you made earlier I was thinking about, and Dr. Michelle can also speak to this too, because I'm gonna out her now. She's an artist, she's a vocalist, serious vocalist who studied a lot. But I think that, just to get back to your idea of European music, you know, this whole discussion of hybridity that the Academy discovered, you know, musicians have known for way long before anybody that these categories of something that you can't see, touch, it's a vibration. Musicians have never gotten caught up. It's been known, Jelly Roll Morton, who one of the inventors of jazz, was a classical pianist, right? Could switch from the blues, so the way that styles and music work together is that these boundaries are often more imposed than they are organic to the artist, right? And so, now when we get to the 80s, I definitely don't want to be one of these people. I guess I'm scared about getting old, right? I don't want to be one of these people that says, is new music
there's nothing. They don't have what we have. Like, my father said that about Rick James, because he was a doo-wop person. And he said Rick James couldn't sing, which I took personal offense to. All right? And I just said, well, you're just old. That's your problem. And so I'm trying to do something that, you know, to have a level of continuity in my appreciation. But as a vocalist, do you think that classical training, how did you deal with that in your thing?
Well, because I write about the blues and I write about vaudeville, the early part of the 1920s jazz, I sing classical music and spirituals. I'm in a group that we're performing with Catholic Battle the next month. So the imposition of looking at the lines, yes, you can talk about the origins of where it comes from, but you can code switch very easily. You can sing a jazz song if you've been trained in the theory and the method of the music, whether it's classical, R&B, funk, pop. You can make those transitions in terms of how you were performing. Now, how it's being received by the audience is a little bit different.
Right.
They're not going to expect me to be seeing a torch song when I'm supposed to be seeing, you know, an aria coming from Carp. But you can make those switches if you've had the training.
Well, unfortunately, we're out of time. I wanted to thank everyone for a wonderful panel, and if we could give the panel a round of applause. I'm going to turn the mic over to Salah, and then we have the concluding remarks and the...
But thank you so much.
All right. It's
been a wonderful... there is a lot to be said, and I know it is in the program that I'm supposed to do concluding remarks. I'm sure you must be very exhausted. You don't want me to recap what happened. It has been really rich and thought-provoking, and I personally love it greatly. It's an area that is not mine. I bother on it from the visual, and my question is going to be on the visual, but I can ask over dinner or a glass of wine, so that is some questions. But what I want to say, but I just want to say really to thank everyone who participated in this. And as I thanked everybody at the beginning of this, the opening of this conference yesterday, from the people who work behind the scene, Triva, Robin, Rene, everyone in the starting office that made this very possible. And you will see throughout the day how they work very hard with their families to make sure that this conference will come out in the best way possible. I also ask the presenters, because I think there is something to be said about this conference. Often when you organize conference, people actually sit the night before the presentation. Anyway, they find a way around in small crowd and so forth, slide their presentation and come. But everyone, I must say, when we ask who participated, presented, send us the paper in advance. That allowed the discussants really to have the time to prepare, as you've seen, all without an exception, took the time to read the paper thoroughly, to prepare, you know, very well thought out remarks. So thanks to all the discussants in addition to the presenters. Before we conclude, Professor Hannes said he wants to say you still up to that?
Yeah.
I told you you were told to be restrained yourself.
Well, I've been thinking about how I want to do this, but I just want to share something with the group. If you could turn the lights down. I think I have to speak louder. Just turn. Okay. You won't turn?
The other one's turning towards me, but this is the way it was sent to PDFs.
Oh, okay. This is from an essay that I wrote in sixth grade.
Wow.
I'm a historian.
I know.
My education. And I just wanted, because I figured you wouldn't be able to see this that clearly. But you'll see it says history.
Right. You knew that.
From sixth grade. I wanted to teach history.
So my vocation is one that everyone should give a second thought. The vocation I have chosen is very needy. The country and church, now I went to Catholic schools, you have to understand. Country.
Use the microphone so we can hear you.
Oh, I'm sorry. All right.
Okay.
As I said, given that I went to Catholic school, you can hear this coming through. So my vocation is one that everyone should give a second thought. Vocation I have chosen is very needy. The country and church both need them. I, at one time, considered very much being an engineer or lawyer. But before we can have engineers or lawyers, we must first have someone to train them. I think I can serve God and my country by showing others how to serve them best. The problem today is that our schools are overcrowded and many, many, many teachers are needed. We need baseball players for entertainment, policemen for safety, and doctors for health. But most of all, we need instructors to teach boys. Now, this was the time, okay, how to play ball, to be doctors or policemen. Our church needs us, our country needs us, teachers. We will never have too many. Now, I mentioned here reference to being an engineer or lawyer, and I don't know if the only way this adds to your idea of having a congregation, but in some respects this was being prophetic, because two of our daughters have law degrees and one has an engineering degree. So I don't know if I forecast this some time ago. I can show the others. But anyway, this is my little attempt at humor that I added for this essay. It says, instruct the ignorant, and the guy, the young man is saying, Miss Benson says that I'm the second stupidest pupil she ever had. You were the stupidest. My thanks to the thanks that Sala provided. This has been a wonderful program. It went by so quickly. I mean, it's almost like when we arrived, seemed to me like a few years ago, in Ithaca, New York, and Anita and I were driving down Elmira Road, Route W Street, Route 13, and we sort of looked at each other and we said, is this real? Because we had, flown into Ithaca before for the interview and whatnot, but now we were driving in and we passed all of these tire places and used clothing stores and fast food restaurants and whatnot. We said, is this really the place? But it does seem just like yesterday. I mean, 38 years has gone by so quickly for me. And someone did mention that historians basically never stop. I don't see myself stopping. I see myself just beginning. And it's quite a bit of work. Thank you very much.